great to be with everybody, and I want to first thank Sarah and George Mason University, and I want to thank Bill and Brown and Brown. It's great to be with you, and thank you for allowing us to talk about our new book, which is Names, Numbers, and Network Solutions. And really what I want to say first is a special thanks to a lot of different people. I want to thank George Mason. Bob Beister and I are very pleased to have done this book and try to fill in more of the record of what we believe is the most significant technology innovation of the century, which is the internet. Bob, I want to thank because Bob was a fella. He's not able to be with us tonight. Marianne Beister at the Fed, the Foundation for Enterprise Development, who's representing the Fed and Beister, Bob, really has been an unbelievable great leader and figure in the United States of America. Bob built SAIC starting as one man in 1969 in La Jolla, California. And what he built, and we'll talk about that tonight, was the largest privately held, employee-owned science technology company based in the United States of America. A truly unbelievable accomplishment. Bob was a fella who I met in 1986, and he convinced me, and it didn't take a lot of convincing, to sell our company to SAIC. And we went there, and for us, the rest was history. So he's a great fellow, and I'm sorry he can't be with us tonight. The Foundation for Enterprise Development, the Fed is a nonprofit that really promotes employee ownership all over the world, runs conferences. Marianne's just done one of the great films, I think, documentaries. We the Owners, which is now shown at 7, are signed up at 7 film festivals around the world. If you ever have a chance to see this, this is the core of what motivates people in employee-owned companies. Again, thanks, Bill, Brown and Brown. Northern Virginia Technology Council, close, near and dear to my heart. I'm one of the founders. I'm past chairman of NVTC. So I want to thank Bobby and NVTC. And last but not least, Global Logic, which I'm chairman of here in town with a lot of great, great people in it, technology people, some of whom worked for us at Network Solutions years ago. Mike Voslow, for instance, Kevin Golden, all were Network Solutions people who now work with me at Global Logic. They were kind enough to supply the books tonight. So I want to thank everybody. People have asked me, if we've started to tour and talk about this book, you know, why did you decide to write this book? Why did you and Bob decide at this point to do that? And I want to tell you 3 or 4 reasons we did that. One is we really wanted to tell the story of Network Solutions. A lot of people in the Washington area heard the story over a long period of time, our bits and pieces of it. Are other people that we've talked about Network Solutions in forums and conferences around the globe. So we wanted to tell the story. Number two, we really wanted to record, and I think if you read the book, Vint Cerf, who we asked to do the foreword, talks about how this fills in some real interesting gaps in the history and evolution of the internet. So we wanted to put that out there as a historical piece that people could refer to for many years. Third, and I think most importantly to both of us, we wanted to personally thank all the thousands of men and women all over the world who worked with us at SAIC and Network Solutions. I cannot tell you how honored and privileged I have been to work with all of those people. Some of the hardest working, smartest, most dedicated people who let no obstacle stand in their path to make SAIC the largest company of its type in the world, and Network Solutions to be the core centerpiece to allow every human being on Earth to get on the internet every day for the 5 years we owned NSI. There are a number of those people here tonight who are not only good friends, but some of the very best business and technical people, financial and legal people in the entire world, and most of those people live and work here in the Washington, D.C. area. So we have been blessed, every one of us who lives in this region and area, to be here. Everybody in the world wants to be one of two places if they're in the tech industry. They either want to be here in the greater Washington region or they want to be in Silicon Valley. So, you know, we are blessed to have built this type of community with the great people we have. And we need to keep that up because the competition increases all the time. And I want to thank all of the other people, Bob and I have talked a lot about this, who didn't work for us but helped us. And I think of people like Larry Oliva, who's sitting in the audience tonight. Larry was our outside audit partner for PwC in those days, helped us through all of our public offerings, on and on and on. So we have lots of suppliers, vendors, people all around us, investment banks, etc., who we could not have done this without their help. And I think the last reason is we really wanted to point out some of the lessons that we learned. Bob was in business for over 40 years. I've been in business now just about the same amount of time. We've learned an awful lot, and I'll talk at the end of this about some of the major lessons we learned. So if you read the book, and I'm going to give you a quick synopsis tonight, and I'm going to refer to some people who are sitting in this room tonight as I go through this, because we've got some of the people who all played a big part in this story. We were a small part of it. There's a much bigger story here that continues on today, which is the evolution and continued growth of a multi-trillion dollar industry that is the internet. So let's talk about in the beginning. In the beginning, the internet in the early 1960s, this was a brainchild that came out of the United States Department of Defense in the agency in those days called ARPA, Advanced Research Projects Agency. It's been known now for many years as DARPA. I put a J.C.R. Licklider up there from MIT because when I first came to Washington in 1969 and was assigned to ARPA through the United States Navy as a scientific technical officer, one of the first things that I was assigned to do was to take a look at a lot of the work that Licklider from MIT had done. And his writing, which basically contained some of the concepts of something he called the intergalactic network, which became the ARPANET and internet, was really one of the key great thinkers behind what today is the internet. So as a very young guy, when I came to Washington here in the science and technology community, he was one of the people that really had an influence on me. In 1969, we'll move ahead from the early 60s, when ARPA put the first money in, where's Steve? Steve Lukasik. Raise your hand. Is Steve still here? Steve was here earlier. Steve Lukasik, who was at ARPA in those days, was one of the people who put the very first dollars into this ARPANET concept and idea. I'm sorry Steve's not here, but he was here earlier. He was really one of the people who started to think about why we should fund something like this concept of the ARPANET. So in 1969, when I showed up on the scene in Washington out of graduate school, Northwestern in Evanston, Illinois, the ARPANET went operational. I happened to be there in one of the very first users group when they turned on the switch. So from 1969 to 1971, I used this thing called the ARPANET. And we basically sat in front of dumb terminals and we communicated with our internal government folks, our outside contractors, and it was basically very slow, clunky, terrible email. That was our first operational use when we were at ARPA from 1969 to 71. Really at that time, my journey began, which led to the acquisition of Network Solutions in 1995. So one thing I always talk about when I'm asked to speak around the globe at tech conferences and business conferences is I'm a real long-term technology wave person. If you look at this story, in the early 1960s, ARPA funded what became the internet, and I intersected with it in 1969, and then that led me by a very circuitous route to follow it all those years, get to know the people who were involved, and actually to purchase Network Solutions. So this took literally from the early funding in the 1960s to when Netscape went public in 1994 that started the internet boom in Silicon Valley. It literally took 30 years for the internet to go from an early idea, concept, and funding to any monetization of the internet. So these things take a long period of time. The 1980s, DARPA turned over jurisdiction of the internet to the National Science Foundation. One of the primary reasons they did that, and there's a good reason for it. The Department of Defense, as most of you knows, through DARPA, they fund these things for some period of time, and then they try to turn them over to the other services, or they'll ship them out to another agency. In this case, most of the users by the 80s of the ARPANET, which became the Internet, were academic institutions. They were the primary user through those years, not business people, not people outside of the education community. There were certainly government users, but not many. In the 1990s, the National Science Foundation transferred jurisdiction to the Department of Commerce. And in that instance, this was in the days of the Clinton administration when we basically got involved through Network Solutions. That was transferred over because the National Science Foundation said, this has gone far beyond being an academic tool. This potentially has broader commercial use, and it went to the Department of Commerce. Network Solutions. I want to, Ty, raise your hand. Ty Grigsby is one of the four founders of Network Solutions. Gary Dessler, Ed Peters, Emmett McHenry were the other three founders. So if you talk about a great entrepreneur in the Washington, D.C. area, you're looking at one in Ty Grigsby. Ty took a risk. He and the other founders went out there and literally hocked themselves up like all good entrepreneurs do. He started that company, and they worked and worked and worked to build Network Solutions. So Network Solutions was founded, and I should let Ty tell the story, not me, founded in Washington in 1979, and it was a small business from the time of its founding until we acquired it at SAIC in 1995. Network Solutions performed technical services for both the U.S. government and commercial clients, banks primarily, other folks, some state business. And in 1992, this was a seminal event for Network Solutions. They bid and won the NSF Cooperative Agreement in late 1992 to be the exclusive seller of .com, .net, .org to every person and organization around the globe. This contract also allowed handling of .gov, .mil, .edu, country codes, plus the entire technical infrastructure in part at that time to handle all the underlying IP addressing. So for those of you who do or don't understand how this works, why Network Solutions was so vitally important was because no human being on earth could type in www, in those days, AOL.com, today Google.com, Facebook, anything else, without Network Solutions resolving that, meaning matching the name in the browser to the underlying corresponding IP address. So this was a company that held the keys to the Internet kingdom. Without Network Solutions operating 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, no human being on earth could get on the Internet. So think about that kind of situation. SAIC, where do these things intersect? In 1969, Bob Beister, who was a PhD nuclear physicist, founded Science Applications International in La Jolla. And as I said before, SAIC grew to become the largest company of its type based in the United States, reaching at its height $11 billion in annual revenue with 44,000 employees. And SAIC, over this course of history, became a New York Stock Exchange publicly listed company in 2006. And Tony Morocco, Tony, hold your hand up. Tony is the new CEO of SAIC. If people have followed this in the Washington area, SAIC has now split into two companies. SAIC, that Tony is a CEO, and Leidos, John Jumper, is the chairman and CEO. I came to SAIC when I sold our company to Bob Beister in 1986. Now, why did we do that? We had grown a very good, we thought, scientific technical company here in Roslyn, Virginia. And we were at that time about 250 technical folks. We did mostly work for the Department of Defense, DARPA, some other classified agencies. I felt at that time, I'd watched, coming here in 1969, the growth and continual evolution of the government contracting industry in the Washington, D.C. area. I made a decision to sell our company because we wanted to get on a bigger train. And of the six companies I've talked to, four of them were interested ultimately in buying us. But I was sent to La Jolla, California by the guy who was basically at that time, we called him the mayor of SAIC in Washington, a guy named Dave Huebner, who I'd known in the Department of Defense. Dave said, go see Bob Beister. You guys are like two peas in a pod. You're entrepreneurs. You'll love talking to each other. I went to see Bob. Bob and I, typically, one of those meetings, going to do an hour and a half. What's CSM? What's SAIC? We spent 5 hours together and sitting in his office in downtown La Jolla, California. When I left there, I thought, this is the right company to sell to for three reasons. Number one, of all the companies that I see at this juncture in Washington in the government contracting industry, I believe that this will be the biggest technical services company. I'm going to bet on that. I may be right, I may be wrong. They were $500 million at that time with 5,000 employees. Number two, I like to work with very smart entrepreneurs. Bob Beister was one of the smartest, gracious, technical entrepreneurs that I have ever met. And he turned out to be that for this country. Number three, I love the model of employee ownership, where everybody from the chairman of the board to the janitor could own stock in a company. And every day they came to work, they did not come to work because they were just working in a company. They were there because every hour they put in, they could see the financial return because they all owned stock in the company. That, I'm telling you, is a magic formula. And in the years that SAIC did that, the stock price increased every single quarter as a private company for years and years and years. We fortunately had people who never wanted to be anything more than the best technical people they could be, who ended up making enough to live for their entire life out of what went on at SAIC as we grew it. So it was a model that I thought our people deserved. One antidote I'd give you was, for some years, as I would drive around on the weekends, and maybe that was just a crazy thought of mine, I would go into SAIC and Jim Russell would always be sitting at his desk on Saturday all day working. I would go in on Saturday. I'd occasionally go in on Sunday afternoon. How I could tell that this was working was our parking lots in those days at SAIC were a third or a half full of cars, just like a normal work day. There were hundreds of people in working in that company day and night. Nobody ever worked 9 to 5. They didn't work 8 to 6. They worked all the time. I would drive around the Beltway and I would look at our competitors' parking lots. They were empty, virtually, on the weekends. We were really onto something there that continued and continued and continued. If you're running a company today, you better look at your parking lots, because it's as good an indicator, even with people working at home now, of anything, of how people feel and how highly they're motivated about your company. So it happened that the lawyer that I had used to sell our company to Bob and SAIC in 1986 fortunately introduced me to Ty and Emmett and Gary and Ed in 1987. So it hadn't been 6 months after I'd gone to SAIC before I met the owners of Network Solutions. And I thought three things about them. One was, I liked them tremendously. They were all wonderful people. Number two, these were entrepreneurs who'd started this company and were working hard to build it. And number three, even in those days, they had some very interesting work. They were focused on the area that nobody cared much about, really, called networking, which was the thing to come, in my mind, right, wrong, or indifferent. So, as it went along, in 1993, I stayed in touch with them, and once I saw that they had won the cooperative agreement, we started to talk seriously. And it ended up that in March of 1995, we concluded an agreement with the owners and we bought Network Solutions on behalf of SAIC. So now how does this intersect with one of the craziest business stock market time periods in the history of the United States? From the 1960s, the dot-com boom years, to the early 1990s, almost 30 years, nobody cared about the internet, and 99% of the world did not know what it was. I believe that is a true statement, because you can look at January the 1st of 1995 at the bottom of these charts. in all those years, by January 1 of 95, there was a total of 71,000 domain names that had been registered. Nobody cared. Okay? They didn't see it coming. They just didn't see it. 1994, the internet boom really got kicked off in people's mind, the general public, when Mark Andreessen and Jim Clark took Netscape public in Silicon Valley. That was a monumental time for those of us who were in the internet business. The only reason I was really interested was I had been coming and going for years to Silicon Valley on business. I knew a number of people there. And is Jorge still here? Jorge's right here. If you want to do an IPO in the technology industry in this country, go see Jorge Del Cavo, who runs that practice at Pillsbury and has been sitting in the middle of Silicon Valley for 30-some years. I started to talk to people in 1992 and 3 in Silicon Valley, and they were asking us in Washington what the internet was. For the most part, they did not know what the internet was. This was a Washington creation. It had been a federal government research project that had been used for all those years. So I started to go out and talk to people, and one of the conversations I'll never forget is Jorge and I talked about this, and Jorge could see what was happening in the Valley because of his technology practice. So what happened, as most of you who are old enough to remember that, when we talk about this with young folks and students around the country, they don't remember any of this, of course, because they weren't there, right? They don't remember this. 1995 to 2000, hundreds of dot-com companies went public. The U.S. stock market boomed. Most had little or no business substance. Hundreds went under. Billions of dollars were made and billions lost by investors. So if there was ever a rip-roaring Wild West time, all of us at Network Solutions can tell you that's when it was, and we lived through it day and night. 2000 to the present. In March of 2000, right when we signed the agreement to sell to VeriSign at the very height of the internet boom, the market right after that started to decline. The decline began, which came to the internet boom and bust. The foundation, though, was laid in those days for what we see today. The Googles, the Amazons, the Yahoos, the thousands of profitable, growing internet companies, the foundation out of all that rubble and mess was laid in those days. So one of the things we learn is that when there's a giant collapse and a pile of smoldering rubble, you better be picking through the pieces and you better start making your bets, because that's the time to do it. And in 1995, in January, as I said earlier, there were a total of 71,000 domain names registered. Now, most of you can look at this chart, and what's happened from 95 on has been unbelievable in terms of the growth of domain names registered. Hundreds of millions today have been registered, and the average daily queries have gone literally through the roof, almost now maybe over 100 billion. Bob, you would probably know that number. So here's the financial story. In March of 1995, we bought Network Solutions for $4.7 million. In 1997, and the people who are responsible for a big part of this are in this room tonight. Gabe, raise your hand. Gabe Batista. We hired Gabe to come in and be our CEO for two good reasons. We needed somebody who had a great long-term track record, who had been very credible in the commercial sector of industry. None of us had been in the commercial sector of industry. We'd all been in the government business. Number two, we were looking for somebody who was very articulate, could go out with our bankers and do the job and get that done, because we'd never been through an IPO. Gabe came in and did all those jobs and ran the company at that point in the company's history for us. He did a great job for us. So we did the IPO in 1997. By then, the machine of the internet boom was going full force. Every day, every paper had it on the front pages. Who's next to go out at a $1 billion valuation? We raised $67 million at $18 per share. It was oversubscribed, as I recall, three times. And the guy who was a magic man for us, who did all of those things day and night with our bankers was Bob Korzenewski. Bob, raise your hand, buddy. Bob Korzenewski and I had worked together at SAIC. He was my CFO, basically, my finance guy in our unit of the company, and I took Bob with me. He and I went to Network Solutions. There were only three of us who went from SAIC to Network Solutions originally. Bob, myself, and Don Talage, who worked for my business unit. So Bob was a magic man. He converted himself from a great finance guy in SAIC to a great public CFO and served in that role the entire time from when we went public until we sold the company. So Bob, we owe you a lot of money, buddy, but I guess we really don't. You got plenty out of it. So let's see. 1999, we did a follow-on offering that raised $779 million on Wall Street, and at that point in time, that was the largest internet offering of all time. In 2000, we did a third offering that raised $2.3 billion. Again, that became the largest pure internet offering of all time. And I noticed when I was looking at these tonight, that number's transposed. SAIC itself received $3.2 billion from these offerings, the largest commercial transaction at that time in SAI's history, which was put back into SAIC to help fund and build the company for the benefit of everybody for the next X number of years. And in March of 2000, as I said, right at the very height, literally, the internet boom, VeriSign, a Silicon Valley company that basically was the PKI certificate company, so security certificates to verify things on the internet, bought us for $19.3 billion. Bill, you said 19.6. We looked at all those figures. We went back to J.P. Morgan. So it's actually 19.3, but what's a couple hundred million dollars, right? So VeriSign found out about us because when we put the board of directors together, we put the fella in about 97, I guess, 98 maybe, who was a CEO of VeriSign in Silicon Valley. And I think what Stratton saw over time was this was a lot better business in terms of cash generation than the business he was running. So their stock had run up like so many companies, and they came in and offered us that. One of the lessons is, when do you get out? Well, $19.3 billion was hard to turn down, and we sold the company at the height of the boom. The return on this deal is one of the largest in Wall Street histories from the dollar figure that we purchased it for until the ultimate sale price. Still holds one of those records today on Wall Street all these years later. So, what are our themes and what did we learn? There are lots of great business stories. Many of you in this room have built great companies. You've lived through great stories. This is one of the great stories, and we think we learned a lot of stuff here. Number one, of four of the most important lessons, the first one is government and industry must work together to create massive innovation. I can't say this strongly enough because we've got a big innovation problem in this country today, and all of us in the tech industry know it. The U.S. government seeds and the private sector operationalizes while creating jobs, innovation, and wealth. If we do not rededicate our nation to this, we're going to lose in the future. So DARPA is probably, I think, my opinion, everybody can have their own opinion, the seed operation in the United States government that has developed technology that has found its way into more trillions of dollars of commercial product and service than any other single agency. If we had 50 DARPAs, I'd give them most of our money in the country. They've come up with satellite communication, GPS, video teleconferencing, stealth technology, the latest chip technology that's now revolutionizing that industry, and the internet. How can you beat a record like that when you got very few people contracting out and using the best science and technology talent in this country? It's hard to beat. If we would not have had great counterparts in the United States government to work with us through the entire 5 years of Network Solutions, I'm not sure that much of any of this would have happened. And I give unbelievable credit to the people in NSF who spent untold hours trying to figure out with us what the right thing to do to transition this from a little $2 or $3 million fixed price contract to commercializing the entire internet on the domain name system basis. These were great people. They were smart. They were doing the right things for the United States of America. And I cannot tell you how many times we sat down and discussed with them what we're trying to do here as a private company and as a United States government is do the right things. How do we do this for the benefit of every person in the United States? And we truly believed, with a lot of people by then in the internet community, for citizens of the entire world that could someday run trillions of dollars of commerce and interaction over this nascent thing in the 1990s. One of the people in this room that I give enormous credit to, George, raise your hand, Senator George Allen. George Allen, who was governor of our great state of Virginia and then became our senator, in the midst of our trials and tribulations, of the press talking about these are bad people at Network Solutions, they've got this monopoly. How did they get it? They called us up to testify in Congress, on and on and on. One of the topics that started to emerge on Capitol Hill was there are always groups of people who the first opportunity they have to tax something, they start to plan how to do it on Capitol Hill. I can tell you that from living in this town for 40 years. That is the wrong way to think about things. You should be trying to understand what this is and what the benefit is to the citizens of this country. We at Network Solutions, our team of people, led by Jay Colleen, who's not here tonight, Jay wanted to be here, who was the head of government affairs at SAIC, who came to help us, we started to bring out busloads of people who were members of the United States Congress, the House of Representatives, and key senators. In that time period, we brought out almost 200 members of the United States Congress to Herndon, Virginia. Why did we do that? I can tell you tonight there were not five people in the United States Senate by the year 2000 who really had any idea what the internet was. They weren't technology people. I didn't expect them to be. Most of them were not business people, but they had no concept of what this was or what it could ever be. So all of us worked day and night to educate the United States Congress. We did that by sending all of our people, technical business people, to the Department of Commerce. We educated Bill Daley and his staff. He was Secretary of Commerce under Bill Clinton. We went and met with people at the White House, Ira Magaziner. We met with Al Gore, on and on and on, to try to tell people what the internet was, what the role of Network Solutions was, and last but not least, what this could possibly become if you didn't put government restraint and regulation all over it. And there were a growing number of people in the U.S. Congress who wanted to do exactly that. Why? I've said this a number of times. George Allen was the man when we went to Capitol Hill, who was our senator in the state of Virginia, who took this upon himself. He listened, he learned, he got educated, he got it. This is a guy who basically led the charge to stop taxation on the internet in the United States of America. If we wouldn't have had his support and the ones he rallied, who were lots and lots of people as time went on in the U.S. Congress would have started to tax the internet, and we would have never had anything like we've seen today if you would have taxed it in the early to mid years of the internet boom. So George, thank you again, because that single act, which took an unbelievable amount of effort and work on your part with your colleagues, saved the United States internet industry, in my opinion. Business is a good and positive force and needs to be supported and nurtured in our nation. A strong, vital, and innovative private sector leads a nation to prosperity. And without it, we face economic decline. One of Bob and my great concerns, and we've lived in this town for 40 years, is that we have fewer and fewer people in the political process that understand the role of business. We have fewer and fewer people who see its true, real benefits, which is to build great companies, employ thousands of people so they can feed their families, buy cars, educate their children, buy homes, on and on and on. That is what this society is built on. People who do not understand that talk endlessly about business is not a good force. It's negative. They all have endless things to say about every wart and pimple on every business in the United States of America. We need to change that completely, because this is the force that operationalizes these types of things and creates billions of dollars of commerce for the good of our citizens. Third, we say this a lot to students when we talk to them. If you want to live in a fast-paced, challenging, exciting, and rewarding world, then the tech field is a place to be. It is always the future because it's where we create the future for everybody on earth. A lot of you in this room have been in it forever. I've been in it my whole career. I have seen this change time and time again. One of the reasons that it's such a great place to be is if you don't like change, you shouldn't be in the tech industry. If you like change and thrive on it, you ought to be there because it is ground zero all over the world for every new innovation that comes out that finds its way into people's lives. It's a great, great positive place to be. Last but not least, I guess everybody would feel this way, but unfortunately, lots of people don't operate this way. One of the great things about SAIC, for all those years we were all there, and we tried to do exactly the same thing at Network Solutions, was you got to be honest, you got to be ethical, you got to work hard, and you never give up. These are the keys to success, and this is what we always tried to do at SAIC and Network Solutions. We were simply groups of people who thought there was no obstacle that was too hard to overcome. We never talked about being stopped. We knew there were 1,000 things that could happen, but we never adopted that philosophy. We were positive, we moved forward, we were always for growth in revenue and profitability, and how did we do that? Some of the themes of our book were, you need to always run a company to be ready to exploit opportunities. We could spend all night talking about that, but I'm telling you, you got to be adaptive, you got to be flexible, you've got to be willing to think outside of the box. Don't let your operations and companies become bureaucratic. If they do, the best and the brightest will simply exit stage left. There are too many other great companies they'll go to across the globe. Number two, you got to build a solid financial base. Most companies that I have seen over 40 years in business, here and overseas, that started up, failed for one of two reasons. They didn't focus on ever making money, so they didn't create a solid financial base, and if the money and the foundation's not there, it doesn't matter about anything else. And number two, they hired the wrong people. People make all the difference in the world, and leaders make great companies. And if you don't have that combination in chemistry, you probably should leave those companies and go somewhere else because there are plenty of places that do. The number one thing I really believe we believed and we tried to practice over all those years was bring the best talent across diverse capabilities. One of the proudest things to Bob and I are all the people, many of whom are sitting in this room tonight, who were the best and the brightest in every kind of field, science, technology, management, finance, business, etc. We would search anywhere we could to try to lure those people to SAIC and then Network Solutions. And we fortunately were able to collect up those kinds of people who worked day and night, who were totally motivated, had a mission, and knew where they were going. They never gave up about anything. Those are the kind of people you want to surround yourself with every day of your life. Engage with the government and in the political process. I've said enough about that. A lot of companies purposefully avoid getting involved in the public policy issues and purposely don't get involved in the political process. Everybody can make their decisions about that. Maybe it's because I've been here for 40 years in Washington. You need to know those folks. You need to educate them on what your problems are and what business needs. You need to cooperate and understand their world. And if you don't engage in that world, you really don't get that. And I think that for years and years and years, our brethren in Silicon Valley avoided Washington like the plague. One of the biggest changes I have seen in the last 10 years in the Washington area is the now flood of presence of Silicon Valley companies into the Washington, D.C. area. They've wised up about this, so they now have government affairs staffs. They are building big business bases here. They really never liked Washington. They thought politics was irrelevant, et cetera, et cetera. We never believed that in this community, but I think we're seeing a sea change in attitude, and all companies should be involved in it because it is a big driver of what goes on in your business. Last but not least, you do need to learn when to move on. We saw an opportune moment. We weren't smart enough to know that was the height of the internet boom. But we thought, you know, this is too good to pass up. We've had an unbelievable run here. We've done what we needed to do because we have tried honestly to be the stewards of a great public trust that was encompassed in the cooperative agreement from the National Science Foundation. We looked at it that way the entire time we ran Network Solutions. So there are times to move on in life, and there are times when you need to exit stage left, and you need to think about that when the right times are to do things like that. So the last thing I'll leave you with is, what's amazing to me is there are still people today who avoid buying internet stocks. If you would have invested your money starting back at the beginning of the wave, you would have certainly lost some and you would have gained some. But this is one of these waves in business, technology, and financially that has not only gone on, think about what you've got today. Google just went over $1,000 a share. Tencent in China, you know, we knew at Network Solutions that what was going to happen, because we worked with countries and country codes, was that everything that started here over time, and it would take time, was going to infiltrate every country in the world. More people were going to get on the internet. Then as guys like Amazon and others started to sell things, people were going to buy stuff. So the numbers continue to climb in mobile commerce, using the internet to buy every kind of good and service. We are still, in my mind, at an early stage of the internet wave continuum. So, you know, if you're not on it, you better think about how to get on it. Because what's happened is once that infrastructure for the internet was laid, and it still continues to be upgraded, enhanced, the mobility wave got laid on top of that. And now we're getting into things like cloud, big data, data analytics, on and on and on. This is going to go on for 20, 30, 40 years, everybody's lifetime in this business. So, you know, you better be on it. You better understand it. Number two, I continue to be impressed as globalization in the companies I'm involved in, and all of you probably, or some of you are, as this has moved across the entire globe, the United States still is the place to be. And, you know, we can debate about decline or not. I'm not a decline guy. This is always going to be the place to be. And the reason is because of the culture, the regulatory framework, and the freedom to do things in this country. You've got a mix of stuff that nobody else in the world does. People are trying day and night to get that mixture. Are they creeping up in some countries? You bet. But is this a place to be? 100%. And number three, and Bob and I really want to get this message across in the book, we really have to rededicate ourselves to building great innovative companies which will drive jobs and economic growth in America for future generations. We both feel strongly, and we've talked about it in the book, that, you know, we do have a problem. These are solvable problems. We've always been problem solvers in this country. What we need to do is rededicate this country at every level. The local, state, federal, on the government level, the businesses need to rededicate themselves to building these kinds of companies. Because the biggest problem here and around the world in your lifetime, your entire lifetime, and my lifetime has been two issues, jobs and economic growth. For 15 years with SAIC, I traveled the Middle East. That was one of my beats, all the Middle East countries. The biggest single problem in that region, there were never enough jobs. Those systems could not create good, viable jobs. The government simply put more people on the rolls. When you'd go to Asia for years, it was the same thing. Now, that's changed a lot in Asia, and thankfully. Go to South America, same kind of problem. Not a lot of innovation. Africa, a wasteland. I've been to all of those places. I've done business with in all of those places over many years. So when people talk in their political campaigns about we've got to have more jobs and economic growth, they're exactly right. The problem is we don't have enough of those anywhere in the world, and this country's job growth rate and production of new innovative jobs for people is really bad right now. And it's not getting much better when you go and talk to people in this country in the tech industry. and the tech industry is booming compared to most other parts of this economy. So this is something that we all need to rededicate ourselves to, because unless we do this, future generations don't have a good prospect of even living the lives we've lived. So Bob and I just wanted to write this book again for those reasons, and primarily to thank everybody who ever worked with us. Because as Bob always said to all of us that was at SAIC all those years, he said, none of us is as smart as all of us. And boy, was he right. You know, it takes a lot of people to build a story like this over many years. Didn't have anything to do with me. It didn't have anything to do with one or two or five or ten people. It had to do with every single person, thousands of people who came into SAIC and Network Solutions and worked and worked and worked and worked smartly and cooperatively together. So I want to thank all of you very much. It's a great pleasure to be with you tonight. I hope you'll read the book. And if you've got feedback, Mary Ann and I are very interested in reading it, because we are hoping to sell at least 1,000 or 2 books before this is over. So thank you very much.